Hi, welcome to the program. This is going to be an exciting program. Yes, I'm almost dressed sensibly tonight. Almost, okay. Got a shirt on because I want to look a little bit more intelligent than I normally do. Because tonight's guest is a lifetime member of Mensa. So I've really got my work cut out tonight. In fact, I've got so much cut out, I'm going to cut out me, and I'm going to leave it to the doctor who's in the house tonight. Now, as I introduce my guest, I'll be reading a few notes, which will be quite unusual for me as well. But we have Dr. Grady Mcmurtry, who's Creation Worldview Ministry. And that's what you'll be finding out more about. And I'm going to go straight to the questions of really asking the doctor. By the way, welcome to the program live on Revelation and Genesis TV.
Thank
in the
you.
UK.
I'm very glad to be here. I can assure you.
Well, as I read your credentials, I mean, I was having a bath, okay, and because I have to multitask because of the time limitations on my life, and I was astounded at your testimony. Coming from the background you have, from such an early age of being taught and then being a teacher in creation, not creation, sorry, in evolution as part of your upbringing for many, many years, and looking at it from a scientific point of view, being able to teach others, absolutely amazingly from, a very early age. How old were you exactly when you started teaching?
I actually started teaching others when I was 8 years old.
I mean, 8 years old. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. I nearly went down the plug hole, seriously. And what happened? Give us some of your background, Dr. Grady.
Well, I was born in San Francisco, California, and raised on the campus of the University of California, Berkeley. And the reason for that was my father was a student there, earned his degrees there, became a professor there, and at one time a secretary to the president. And so I literally grew up on the campus of the University of California, Berkeley, which I'm sure everybody here would know is a very, very liberal place. We call it the capital of liberalism in the States. But because of that, it gave me this opportunity that when I was not in the California public schools learning about evolution scientifically, supposedly, from my teachers, I was also in the paleontology laboratories at the University of California, Berkeley, learning about evolution, dinosaurs, fossils from PhDs when I was only in grade school. And by the time I had hit the third grade, was 8 years old, they started borrowing me from one classroom to the next in the California public school system. And I was teaching other children about dinosaurs, fossils, evolutionary theory, because I knew more about it than the teachers did. And so I went on to not only become a steadfast evolutionist, but to earn my science degrees at other universities, and indeed taught evolution from the seventh grade of our state schools through the university level at secular universities. But at the age of 27, I was challenged to reevaluate the science that I had learned. And so what happened was I spent 16 months reevaluating with a blank sheet, creation and evolution, to determine whether the science that I had been taught and had taught others was true or not, or whether in fact they were false and creation was correct. And at the end of 16 months, so this was a process, I became a biblical scientific creationist, a person who believes 100% from the Bible and 100% from science that creation is true, occurred 6,000 years ago, exactly as the Bible says, that the Bible contains many incredibly accurate scientific statements, and that there is much science to support creation and a young creation, and there is no science to support an old earth, old universe. There is no science that supports evolutionary theories. It's really junk science. That the only real science supports creation.
I can hear the phones wanting to ring. We're going to hold back from taking phone calls tonight till the second hour. So Dr. Grady's going to stay with us until the second hour. It is the 29th of January, just for those that might be watching a repeat. So stand by. We can take emails meanwhile. Try to keep them succinct, just to the point. I can't read out long emails. But your questions that you've been wanting to ask from the beginning of time, if I excuse the phrase, but you want to know really how can such a man with such credentials, and you didn't really mention some of the other credentials that you have as well, which might come out later on, but it's not to puff the man up, but the thing is that what we do need in this day and age, and I thank God that you've actually come to this country, because we do need people who can make a defense for our faith. And because people like myself are just not intelligent enough to be able to put into words, and also with the background that you've got as a scientist, to give the arguments to show that really creation, as per the Bible and the book of Genesis, is what actually happened, because we're living in a society that as the worldview is very different from the biblical view. So I don't want to waste any more of this precious time to let you just give some of the arguments that so often come up from people who would say, well, I can't accept the Bible's account of creation because of...
Well, first of all, I would like to say to the Christians that are listening that one of the major problems we have is that the Church Universal has forgotten our history. The Church Universal, I'm talking about all Christian denominations and so forth in all countries, has forgotten that it is the intellectual side of the Church that made the Church great. That, in fact, we are called in the Bible to have a rational, reasonable, logical, and evidence-based faith. And the Apostle Paul particularly talks about this, and that's why I'm a creation evangelist in the line of Acts 17. The Apostle Paul started creation evangelism in Acts 17, and I'm simply following in his footsteps as a defender and apologist of the Christian faith. Now, there are many reasons to know that evolution is not true in the sense of one organism evolving into a different kind of organism. There are many scientific reasons to know that the Earth, the solar system, the galaxy, and the universe are young, and that there are millions and billions of years never happened. Many people don't realize this, but actually the millions and billions of years have no proof. They were simply invented by atheists, primarily six French atheists in the 1700s, two Scottish atheists of the late 1700s, and I apologize, after all, I'm Scottish. And then you go into a chain of English atheists and agnostics, all three Darwins, because we have Erasmus, Robert, and Charles Darwin. You also have others like Malthus and Lyell and so on, Huxley. But actually, they invented the millions and billions of years to support a theory simply to say that the Bible was not telling the truth. The only reason that these atheists invented the millions and billions of years, and you have to realize that there were French atheists who were saying that the Earth was up to 2 to 3 billion years old in the mid-1700s. Now, this is before any modern technology came along that would support this in any way, shape, or form. None of those methods work. But before even any of those methods came into existence, evolutionists had already brought into existence the idea that the Bible was not telling the truth, because they were anti-Christian, anti-Bible, and they were anti-creation. And they were anti-creation because they wanted a religion that would support their atheism and their agnosticism. And so the only way to attack the Bible, really, if you think about it, is to attack the age issue. That if the Bible is not telling the truth about the Earth being 6,000 years old, the universe being 6,000 years old, then how can you trust it about anything else? And so to create doubt in the age of the Earth and universe would then create doubt in the rest of the Scripture. So they attacked the age of the Earth, but they simply invented the millions and billions of years. I mean, none of them agreed on how much time it was. They constantly change. You have French atheists in the mid-1700s who say it's 2 billion, 3 billion, and yet you have Hutton who says it's just millions and millions. In 1850 here, there were two different evolutionists who wrote the Earth was 25 million and 100 million years old in the same year. So obviously they didn't agree with each other. They all had different ideas. And there is no uniform theory of evolution. No two of them agree on exactly how it happened. But these modern techniques that people are familiar with don't work. But they didn't even come into existence until 50, 60 years ago. So obviously they didn't use them. They just invented them. And then they try to use these techniques to support them, but they don't. And so the biggest single issue is time. But you also have to remember that what evolutionists tell you is in the ground is not what's really there. The fossils are there, the layers are there, but nowhere in the world can you find the layers in the order that you find in the textbook. The textbook is a situation where they have rearranged the layers from various parts around the world into a column printed in the textbook, but nowhere can you find it. It simply doesn't exist. So what you have there is simply the putting together of evidence from different places to support their theory. And if you think about it, evolution is inconsistent with the various laws of science, it's inconsistent with natural process, and it's inconsistent with the physical evidence. Now, once you've looked at law, process, and physical evidence, there isn't anything left to look at scientifically. And so those are the kinds of conclusions that I came to, and that's the kind of thing that people need to be exposed to in the general public.
there, as I said, there's going to be lots of questions tonight because we do have a viewership that don't accept the Bible, and which is really good because they're challenged. They're keen enough to be able to argue, and we do have that sort of debate side to our television ministry, and I thank God for it. But so we are going to, in fact, if you would call your neighbor, your friend, someone that you know at work who is very much into evolution, and I understand that because there's very little that the church actually puts forward as a scientific argument to why, you know, we are created and intelligently designed, don't look at me, by a loving God. But the time issue, as you say, is the thing that really hangs everybody up. How did you overcome this, with you, particularly given your background as someone who was teaching others from the age of 8 and probably, no doubt, all the way through to your
early age, yes.
27.
Yes.
You said you were 98% Christian, you know, sort of intellectually.
I became a Christian at the age of 27. I was an evolutionist, an atheist, until I was 27 years old. I became a Christian in a search for truth. It's really very simple, and this argument, of course, is nothing new with me, but either Jesus is telling the truth or he's not.
And what
either is the
point?
Son of God or he isn't.
Okay, right.
And therefore, that is a simplistic way of looking at it, but it's very succinct. And the fact of the matter is that at 27, I was challenged to look at that question. Is Jesus telling the truth or he's not? And I took my scholastic and my academic skills. I did not have somebody witnessing to me, as we say in Christianity. I didn't have somebody trying to argue me into the kingdom. I didn't have somebody trying to persuade me into the kingdom of God. I simply took that question, and on my own, reading works of others, but the Bible and also other apologists' writings and histories. Josh McDowell, for example, mm-hmm. but also just histories, Josephus, whatever.
Mm.
But I was looking at histories that are both Christian and non-Christian, looking at the writings of some apologists, looking at the Bible, and ultimately I proved scholastically and academically that Jesus was telling the truth. And so in a room by myself, with nobody else present but the Holy Spirit, I became a Christian. I knew so little about it that once I had made that decision, I went to a pastor and said, is there something else I need to do? I mean, if you think about it, the Bible does not have a checklist in the back end.
That's true.
And so I went to him. He interviewed me. I explained what happened more longer than today, but I did a short job of it. And he said, so your decision is firm. And I said, if you knew me, you wouldn't ask the question. And he said, okay. And then he showed me two scriptures. He said, you need to make it public, and you need to be baptized. And I said, well, it's there. I accept it. And what happened was, the next opportunity, I made it public, and shortly thereafter baptized. But the fact of the matter is, I became a Christian from a 98% intellectual standpoint and a 2% emotional one. Now, everybody comes in a spectrum.
Different.
Some come 98%
mm-hmm.
emotional.
Mm-hmm.
But there's always some intellect involved because you had to make the decision. So some come 2%, 98 this side, some come 98, 2% that side, and everybody else goes in the middle. The good news is, of course, that once I made that decision and had this interview and so forth, I also became a whole lot more emotional about it. But that then made me a saved evolutionist. Now, I'm smart enough to know that's a problem.
You
know, when you became a saved evolutionist, not just with my colleagues, but just philosophically and everything else, once you become a saved evolutionist, you've got a problem, because if you believe in evolution, you've taught evolution and so forth, and now you know and have a personal relationship with the creator of the universe, you've got a problem. And I'm smart enough to know that. So I took the next 16 months, again, starting with that blank sheet of paper, again saying, wait a minute, and started realizing that the laws of science refute evolution, natural process refutes evolution, physical evidence refuted evolution. At the end of 16 months, I became a biblical scientific creationist when I asked myself one last question, which was, could the law of gravity ever evolve? Now, I've been working and teaching